It is a joint event of two small initiatives in this place, which is called Goya. One initiative is called Roma Research and Empowerment Network. We are an informal circle of people living in Hungary, organizing different sessions on the topics around Roma inclusion. And there is another organization which is based here. I'm also a member of this, which is called Helyzet. And I will ask Agi just to say one or two sentences about this organization.
And so we call it Working Group for Public Sociology, Helyzet, which is a Hungarian means position and situation at the same time. And it's a sociological workshop that deals with the global position of Hungary from a political economy perspective and also from a sociological perspective. And we are trying to reread the history of state socialism and the regime change and what has come out of it until today from a leftist political economy perspective.
Thank you. And today we have the privilege to have three excellent speakers. And we would have, as announced, introductory speeches by them. Okay, so please, if you could say a few words about... because I think many of you do not know this place where we are, it's not only a bar.
Yeah.
If you could say a few words about Goya.
This place functions mainly as a community space which would integrate movements active in Budapest and activist groups and the like. And also a community space for the local community, which is somewhat disorganized and is lacking places like this. So it's a community house for all. And it also functions as a cooperative, as an alternative way for organizing work and production. So there are currently like 9 members of this cooperative, and we share the profit equally, or based on the work we put in, we take out an equal share and organize our work democratically. And yeah, that's basically the sum of it. And that's why we welcome events like this.
Thank you. We are very happy to be here. Thanks for hosting us. So I just wanted to introduce the speakers. I think the first speaker will be Dr. Simmons, who has been involved in the civil rights movement in the US, but in the last 2 decades he lived in Hungary. And he has a lot of experience with Roma programs. Then I think we agreed the second speaker will be Abel Beremenyi from the Autonomous University of Catalonia, where he is a teacher and researcher. And he has been researching with the Gitano populations for over a decade. And last but not least, we will have Iulius Rostas, who has experience working with several NGOs. Currently, he is a PhD student at the Babes-Bolyai University, and he will offer us his insights. What we discussed preliminarily is that we will have short introductory speeches, 15 minutes long, where the following very basic questions will be addressed by the three invited speakers. One is to have just a very rough overview of the emancipation struggles in these countries and what they achieved and what they didn't achieve and by what means. Of course, it will be particularly interested in the case of the United States and Spain. Then, what is their opinion, how much we can take these lessons into Eastern Europe and the post-communist setting? And the third one is that what are, as they see, the limits and opportunities of different, let's say, movements, empowerment projects, Roma participation projects, especially here in post-communist Europe, based on the lessons of their home countries. So, please, Michael, I give you the floor.
Thank you, and thank Martin for pulling this together. But before I speak, I do want to say that anything I say is not intended to embarrass or to in any way go demean anyone. Like I say that because I'm going to raise some issues that some consider controversial. I consider true, but some consider them controversial. So I do want to say that right up front. I started working with Roma, believe it or not, in 1990 here in this region. A colleague of mine was doing some research for me and here in the region, and he said, you know, Michael, the Roma in this region, really I identify with the African American struggle, and you know, you ought to check it out, because in the U.S., those who've been there know that the Roma just at best, you know, or fortune tellers are considered or mysterious. So like, but there's no emotional investment in Roma, positive or negative, at least as far as I know. And so of course, when I first came here to the region, that's not just Hungary. I mean, except for Montenegro and Slovenia, I've worked with Roma in virtually every non-Soviet post-communist country. People always ask me, you know, how to start working with Roma, and I always tell them, well, you know, when I came here, people told me that Roma were dirty, lazy, promiscuous, didn't care about education, didn't want to work. In fact, they even told me they steal babies. They, you know, if you go build a house, they'll take the wood and burn it down. I mean, I just said all these things. So as many of you know who have been to the U.S., that's what you were told about me as an African American. And so in the way that I knew it wasn't true about African Americans, I said, well, I'm sure it's not true about Roma. And of course, it's not true without going into all the stories. And then people would always tell me, you know, I would try to find out, you know, why do you hate Roma? And I always say that, you know, there's a very famous movie, I think, called an Italian movie called The Bicycle Thief. And I'm convinced it's Roma. Because from Tirana to Belgrade to Skopje, everybody I know either had the bike stolen by Roma, or they know somebody that had the bike stolen by Roma. I mean, but that's just, I mean, it's just like in the U.S., white kids talk about, you know, some black guy took their lunch money in junior high school or something. I mean, it's just, but it just amazes me, the bicycle thief in East Central Europe. Because I don't see that many Roma on bikes, so I just, well, damn, this. and then people always said, don't go to District 8. Just like I know that if you were in New York, you were told, don't go to Harlem. If you were in Chicago, you were told, don't go to the South Side. If you were in Los Angeles, don't go to White. You're in Philly, don't go to North Philly. So in the way that I know everybody here who's been to the U.S. has been told where not to go because we put people in pipes and cook them, the same thing with Roma. So of course, I mean, I just laugh every time I'm walking up Laha to disregate this nonsense. That's just one aspect that stuck in my mind. But then the other aspect about Roma is this whole, I mean, I really thought because of my experience in the U.S. that, you know, that, well, they're probably mysterious and different and whatnot. Okay, without going into all of the things that I've experienced being with Roma, they're just like everybody else. And I'm always struck that basically everybody I know in academia who studies Roma studies them anthropologically. I mean, I've never seen any research done on what were Roma views on in Germany on the development of National Socialism. What were Roma views after 1945 regarding the advent of communism? What were the Roma views in 1989? Nobody does any research in that I'm aware of, clearly not published, because they are these people that are different. You know, we don't ask them kind of questions. We ask them about housing and you know, giving being treated good. So that the notion of Roma is, as this kind of group outside of at least European culture, if not culture in general, that I'm very clear is not true. And as I tell people, not just with Roma, but I've never been anywhere in the world where people didn't want the quality education for their kids, a job, and a house. Now, some people don't eat pork, some people don't eat beef, some people don't eat meat, some people don't smoke cigarettes, some people take off their shoes and walk into the house. So everybody has their idiosyncratic cultural dimensions, but fundamentally, the Roma are the same as me and you, as far as I'm concerned. I don't care if they're Askali, I don't care if they're Egyptians, I don't care if they're Sinti, I don't care what you call them. They want what I want for myself. So that's the other thing I began to realize. That because I was then working with an international NGO, that I had some resources to do various projects with Roma. And now, I was involved with the civil rights movement in the U.S. The civil rights movement in the U.S. was a grassroots up movement. The Roma movement, as far as I'm concerned, is a top-down movement that stops before it gets to the community. Mm. Let me talk about that for a second. One of the major differences between Roma and African American reality is that probably because of the resources in the U.S., the U.S. had enough resources for African Americans to build a totally alternate community in the South, so that there were African American colleges, you could go from the first grade to PhD, and basically have an equality in action with white people. You could teach at the university. You could Southern communities had doctors, lawyers, everything that a culture needs to sustain itself were in African American communities. They may not have been as good as the resources in the white community, but clearly they were functioning. And the other thing about the African American community, but different from Roma, is that even in its worst period, from slavery, post-slavery, there was always contact between African Americans and white people, not contact of equality. So that during slavery, there was a phenomenon of what we call in a pejorative way, the house Negro, the one that cooked him. I mean, those who may have seen 10 Years a Slave, or have seen even the movie The Butler recently, that we played roles from black women actually literally nursing white babies to doing things in the house, cooking in the house. In fact, it always amazes me how many African Americans who are considered dirty clean up white people's houses, in a way that how many dirty Roma clean up a lot of expat houses here in Budapest. That's another dimension of the irrationality of racism. But here in this region, fundamentally, Roma are totally inside the culture. God, they don't clean up, God, they don't drive taxis, God, they're not orderlies, they're not in the hospitals. Most people can go through life in this region and not have any intimate contact with Roma. And then when they do, it's usually with an educated Roma, and then, of course, they become, quote, the exceptional Roma. It's just like when the white Americans see me, because they call me in this context, because it's not always that, but they call me exceptional. And I always say, exceptional to what? Because just because I'm not running down the street with your television set makes me exceptional. You know, and so in the States, I tell people, exceptional black people sell crack. Exceptional black people steal. And that's the same for Roma, as far as I'm concerned. So that's just one phenomenon. But because they're so outside the culture, I realized that the stereotypes are most of how rigid they are. Because I've been in a room with a comparable, I'm making assumptions about people in this room, with people as humane as I assume the people in this room are. And I've heard some of the most obscene things said about Roma from people, in some cases, who get paid to advocate for Roma. So that's just one aspect of the Roma reality. But the other aspect of the Roma reality, and I think more fundamentally, is what people call the Roma movement, which I think is the most misnamed reality. There is no Roma movement in this region, unless people call themselves, I tell my friends in the U.S., human rights is a job over here. that, like, I've been involved with the human rights, with human rights since I was 17 years old. Sometimes I was employed, but though I was a taxi driver, but I was a human rights activist. When I was mixing cement, I was a human rights activist. People become a human rights activist as soon as they get their first internship at ERC. They get their first job at one of these organizations. But so the human rights is viewed as an employment opportunity. So therefore, you got to pay the piper, because organizations are set up to clearly reinforce themselves. So that in that regard, the Roma reality does not speak here in Budapest, the people in the village. So let me give you one example. Some people may know of an organization called the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, the NAACP. It is the oldest civil rights organization in the U.S. Now, as far as I know, the largest, at least in terms of resource organization in this region, are working with Roma, or at least advocating for Roma, is the European Roma Rights Center. Now, a couple years ago, every time I say this, I laugh. A couple years ago, they hired an executive director who lived in New York City. Not that he lived in New York City and then he got the job and he moved to Hungary. He continued to live in New York City. And he would commute. He would commute. Non-Roma. And as gross as that is, the thing that is the most obscene is that the people who made that decision, not one person cared what a Roma person thought about it. They weren't worried about Roma picking in the ERC's office, because they weren't worried about Roma blocking doors. I mean, that is the total, I mean, those who know the U.S. can't even imagine the NAACP, which is not a radical organization. They can't even imagine a white American becoming the head of it, let alone somebody from this region, commuting. I mean, it's just ludicrous. But it didn't seem ludicrous to anybody. I mean, I'm the only one, I'm the only one who said, what the hell, how could this be happening? I said, if you got a non-Roma from this region, it makes more sense. But how the hell do you get a white man from New York City to fly here every few months with all the economics that involved in terms of his dual reality? So that to me is a metaphor for the Roma movement. Another situation. I've done many trainings with Roma. I mean, I stopped doing them, by the way. But I've done, unless I get paid, which I don't. But I don't get paid because my main benefactor left the country, so I don't get paid anymore. But the assumption of my trainings was that you were going to take this information and go back home. That's not what happens. They take the information and stay here or head to Brussels. But anywhere but home. So that the training becomes, so then there's a little tight group of people throughout this region. And there is no educated Roma in this region, I bet you, that hasn't been to at least four trainings, that don't go to a training per year. And then you say, well, like, what did you do from the last training? I was an intern at ARC. I was intern at REF. I was an intern at OSI. You say, yeah, but how did your training affect your community? And don't nobody even know what happened in the community. So in terms of looking at the situation, I have raised this with people. I said, well, look, you know, why is it that the work doesn't get to the community? So they say, well, because Roma don't speak English, so like, are you going to do? So I say, well, wait a minute now. So now, they deal with a population that is lucky to get any education. Any education. But now, so they're going to be punished because they don't speak English. So I say, well, like, then for the last 20 years, if you didn't do anything else, you could have had a massive American Peace Corps program to just saturate this region teaching Roma English. If you didn't do anything else, since that is the criterion for taking the next step to access the resources. So people say they don't speak English and they're not going to develop a program. So I say, why don't you have a line item in every grant that's ever made for English language training? No. So when I had my, I mean, that it was my NGO, when I had a job, that, like, I've been in rooms where I organized meetings. And then I realized, like, damn, I'm the only one that can't speak the language. Everybody else has a, can speak to each other in their language. So, but because I'm the man with the resources, they gotta come and speak my language. But I say, no. No, no. Get me a translator. You speak in your language. Even if you can speak English, I know that you can communicate better in your language. But that ain't what people do, what people do here. If you can't speak English, you don't get to come, period. That is the unwritten rules. That's just one dimension of the Roma reality. But the other dimension is, and to me this is most important, the process of liberation is as important as being liberated. Now what does that mean? That means that, like, if you think I did it, then you haven't been liberated. I might have, you know, you might have a nicer house, your kids might go to a better school, but it means nothing fundamentally to your reality. So that in terms of the Roma reality, there's this narrative that has been of Roma, these poor, downtrodden people that just can't do nothing for themselves, they can't read, they can't write, people always kick them in the ass, and what people like us do is go and try to make it better. Or we'll speak to them. We'll take a court case to European court. But I say, no. That's not who the Roma are. Because it is my contention that you take a people that's been, I mean, and I just use 500 years as a round number, who have been in a region for 500 years. Everywhere they go, they aren't just disrespected. They've been beat, Holocaust, killed, on and on and on and on and on, in terms of the horrors that we all know. But yet, they survive. They don't just survive, but they're producing college graduates. These illiterate, whatever people that we talk about, they're producing people now who, however small, are lawyers, doctors, whatever. Well, how do they do that? They didn't do that by just being downtrodden and woe is me. I would argue, there was a culture of resistance in the Roman community that nobody uses to organize Roma. So I tell people, hey, tell young people, look, I tried to get money to get cameras and videotapes and go interview whoever is the oldest member of your family. If somebody lived through World War II, put them on, find out how the hell did you do that? How did you do that? Because nobody, as little as people cared about Jews, they cared less about Roma. So how did you do that? And then how did you go from employed from 1989 to unemployed almost totally now? How do you do that? Roma, the word Roma, let me deal with that. That, again, this is not for me to change, so be clear, speak humbly, but this is an opinion. Some of you may not know that up until 1960s, the word for African Americans was either colored or black. I grew up in the 50s. I know I look good, but I grew up in the 50s. I grew up in the 50s. If you call a person black in the 50s, or you had a fight in your hands, you could be 6 or 60. If you called another black person black, you were going to fight. It wasn't even used affectionately. It was just a taboo word for us. And then, as the social movement began to evolve in the 60s, we realized, well, what's wrong with black? So then we took that word back. Now, if you call somebody colored or Negro, that is a pejorative in the black community. So that in 40, 50 years, and it hasn't taken that long, it's just how long it's been, it's been a total reverse. Well, in that regard, that I tell people, what's wrong with the word gypsy?
I still haven't heard anybody tell me what is wrong with the word gypsy. Because that's what Roma call themselves if you've been in the settlements all over this region. I can count the Roma, particularly uneducated, but in general, in the field, who don't have human rights jobs, who don't get a chance to go to Brussels, I can count them on one hand, who call themselves gypsies. The first group I ever worked with here in Hungary was called the Gypsy Mothers Association. So that I say, if it were me, Roma would buy shirts, I'd buy a million shirts, and I'd have on the front, I am gypsy and I'm proud, and I'd have on the back, the only thing but dirty about gypsy is in your mind, or just say, fuck you, whatever. But, I am convinced that just that psychologically would blow people's mind. And again, what is wrong with that word? Someone has to tell me what is wrong with that word. Because if it's wrong, then there's a lot of education to do in the field in terms of Roma.
Maybe just one or two more thoughts, okay. because this is you out.
Yeah. Okay. The fundamental point I want to leave with is that that to me, based on what happens in this region, it is an insult to the African American struggle to suggest that what is going on here is anything similar, because we never went and met with the politicians. We never just walked in there with no power. We never walked into a room with people who had authority over us with no kind of way of at least them understanding that if they didn't do something that we wanted, they were going to have a bad day. We didn't have power to be equal, but they wasn't going to get into their office tomorrow. They were going to have their computers messed up. Something was going to happen, and we were willing to go to jail for it. So what happens? Roma go to Brussels, and the human rights is talking to some MP, or the decade of the Roma. As I tell folks, I say, take me to one Roma settlement next year and tell me, as a result of the decade, the quality of life improved. The head of the Roma decade at a recent meeting, he said, you know, we were too ambitious. He says, but I think if it goes on for 6 years, and this is what he said the net result has been. There are more, it's on the EU agenda now. There are more people talking about it now, except in the villages. That's who I'm talking about it. So that in 10 years, all that money, damn, we could have showed a movie. So that again, when I think about, and in summary, if you will, again, these are more bullet points than a narrative, but I think about the Roma movement. The Roma movement is about 10 or 15 organizations floating around Europe, going to meetings, mainly in Brussels, but also in Geneva, but sometimes New York. A couple people have gotten college degrees. That's about the only positive thing I've seen about the Roma movement. But in the context of the quality of life, after 20 years and damn near 1 billion euro, you show me the results.
Thanks, Michael. We will continue. And in the room, we have some people who may believe that there is a Roma movement, and I think who did really a lot to develop the struggle. And I think there is an emancipation struggle for the Roma. But your points are well taken. And another success story that we hear very often in Eastern Europe is the Spanish case. Maybe you have come across different publications, different events, conferences where the Spanish case of integrating the Gitano population is presented as a positive example. So I would ask Abel Beremenyi to reflect on the Spanish and in particular the Catalan case.
So thank you very much for coming, especially because I didn't really think that so many people is going to come to an event like that. Marci has just said, there's a general opinion that if struggles and empowerment struggles or any kind of improvement of the field of equality, equal rights, whatever, fails in Eastern Europe, there's still a rising star in Europe, which is the Iberian Peninsula, which is Spain. And so this is actually what I'm going to do is just put some ideas on the table. Hopefully we can discuss them later on. Basically, I base my ideas and my opinion and the very fact on a research that we did 2 years ago. And it was a very, I'm anthropologist, and it was really challenging to start an evaluation project, and actually I didn't really think it would happen, because we had other kind of ideas about this reality. But this is how it happens, and this is how we could get some financing. So we started up with this project, and it resulted absolutely troubling for public administration in Catalonia especially. So these are just some ideas and some concepts, and I'm sure that you are familiar with many of them, many of the debates that I'm going to mention, but still I put it on the table because I wonder what you think about it. So first of all, just to say that where the Spanish Roma community, if we can speak about the community, is as heterogeneous as any other in any village or in any region or in any country of Europe. So I'm not going to enter in it because later on we can speak about it. But still, we should mention that the policy making and the policies that are targeting Roma or Spanish or Catalan Gitano population is all the time speaking about something which is abstract, which is the Roma, the Gitano community. And perhaps recently there is one exception, which is the Catalan, because they are trying to get away from Spain. But anyway, there is no such kind of issue. The most important point on it is the two concepts of participation and empowerment, which was the basic issue of this meeting, of this seminar. So one of the things is just that actually we made a review of the critical literature on participation, evidently having read before all the positive examples and the positive or positivist reflections on participation and emancipation, based on some theoretical fundamentals that we find evidently more very important, coming from critical theory of anthropology or anthropological critical theory. But still, we were looking for some evidences to these ideas. So just some ideas, like the very harsh criticism of any empirical social science on the knowledge construction, how the anthropology is just constructing the knowledge, taking away information from the local people or the native people, not involving them in the posterior production of the scientific knowledge, how the local knowledge or the local facts are transformed in a scientific commodity, whatever. Up to the point that there's a lot of debate on it, but up to the point that what happened in the science, and especially in anthropology and development, is that there came a sort of orthodoxy or a very strong belief which was transmitted through discourses and which reached the political decision makers, because they are all the time in need of some kind of positive messages and positive hopes that it can be done. What is the element that is needed? So participation, let's do it in a participative way. It's a very vulgar way of doing it, of saying it, evidently. Behind there's another way of thinking about democracy and democratic state and governance, whatever. But still, this keyword is absolutely a keyword in the 90s and the early 2000s. So, what are the main promises that come from this literature and the policies or the political discourses that are responding to this literature? Just some ideas, like community gains control over the research, and particularly over the representation that the press or that the scientific community is producing and reproducing, etc., etc. Also, the magic word of native voices are coming out, like they are incorporated. That delivers higher quality in the scientific production and credibility to data. Not only scientific production, but also in development projects, the very base data that politicians and development experts need in order to address a problem. And what are the just some challenging elements that are coming from the literature, and which is really amazing that they are not new pieces of information, but rather from the 90s. So the strange is that still we are getting in the same trap, time and time again, with these kind of positive participatory emancipatory projects. Knowing that there are some traps and we could avoid it, evidently. Like one of the most important is the largely lacking evidences, that there are very, very few projects that succeed in the way they were presented as a successful project, at least based on participation. The problems of collaboration, the pitfalls of collaboration between researchers or development experts and the local community, or evidently the idea of taking the community as a compact unit without having in mind all the power relations within it. The oversimplification of the idea of local knowledge, which is evidently is not an unchanging commodity, but rather something that is negotiated continuously in interaction with experts, with mainstream society, with discourses, whatever. Well, a long list, and I'm not going to mention all of them, but I'm sure that you know some of these pitfalls. The next step that we try to find out, and I'm going to mention the real project I want to describe a little bit, is the relation between participation and emancipation or empowerment. The question is whether there's a link between these two concepts or two phenomena. And it's absolutely important to have in mind that generally speaking, we use this concept as something that everybody knows. There are very few projects or very few calls for like European FP7 project calls where participation is well described, is really well defined in order to know what to answer to. So one of the definitions of empowerment is the control over valued resources, evidently it's just one, and the critical understanding of the environment of one, of the individual, of the community. And another definition could be the capacity to make choice. And afterwards, once evidently critically analyzed the situation, I mean an informed choice, not just a choice like that. To the capacity to make a choice and consequently make decisions and carry out actions. And the major problem here is to mix up or confound agency and opportunity structures. And perhaps one of the main problems in the in these empowerment projects or participative projects is that we keep thinking about agency, even if collective agency, we are not addressing structure or structural problems. And I'm going to illustrate it with my example. And finally, a link between empowerment and development, whether empowerment, the way we want to define it, necessary follows up by a development process on an individual or a collective way or sense. So perhaps one of the most important lessons to learn from just some reading in the literature is that there is no empowerment independent of the structures of oppression, structures of power, or structures of or simply relations of power on a community level or simply on an individual level. And the very case I just wanted to put on the table, because it's an interesting and a famous case that is known at least for people who are interested in it, is the project of Roma School Promoting Project, which was part of this wider comprehensive Roma plan, development plan of Catalonia, which was quite positively appraised by European institutions, even by big or large NGOs. It's a sort of reference for other kind of comprehensive Roma plans. And this was the flagship project, the most famous project that was presented everywhere as an example to follow. What happened? It was simply a plan, basically planned by the Department of Education of Catalonia, but there was a formal consulting group which was consulted all the time. There was a sort of planning period of almost a year, a round table, invited very many Roma people, already empowered Roma people, basically from associations, from larger associations, Roma associations. The main promoter of the project has become a Roma so-called grassroots organization. Actually, it used to be created a decade before by the public administration, but still they were enthusiastic young Roma people who participated in it and who handled the funds, a lot of money, I mean, a lot for this NGO, some 3 million euros per year, 2.5, sorry. Public administration provided generous financing to the project, and it included teachers training, so it means that even if it was focused mainly on the Roma family as the focus of the problem for them, there were some kind of intents to involve teachers in training as well. And the most important thing is that explicitly it claimed for the empowerment of the families through negotiation or mediation between family and school. And perhaps another important element is that a group of school promoters was selected, and they were only Roma people, youngsters or even elderly people, but all the time Roma, and they were selected as sort of mediators between school and families. But what's the problem with that? It sounds really good. Actually, the Department of Education presented a sort of evaluation that showed that the turn-up of the of the Roma children, especially the problematic ones, was rising, that increasing, the dropout was going down, the participation of the of these individuals were positive, the participation, the expectations of the family towards the school were positive. Evidently, I'm not going to enter now in methodological questions, but what's wrong with them? So I just put on the table some critical questions rather than affirmations. One of the problems is representation. So the very promoter, this central person, the mediator, Roma mediator, sort of unified the diversity that, that is present in any Roma community, but especially in urban Roma communities in poor neighborhoods, where evidently it's not kinship that brings them together only. So the very fact that a Roma mediator appeared in the school meant that teachers just relaxed because they ceased to have an active relation with families, because anyway, it's not my job on the first hand. On the other hand, it's very difficult. It's a very difficult job. So we have a mediator. I will speak with this mediator, and mediator will speak with the family. So it's a kind of strange dynamic dynamics starting. But also appeared in the teaching staff meeting a unitary voice of a wide range of opinions, interests, political actions, whatever, that should have happened if all the occurred, if all the families had been invited to these meetings, evidently. So it was now only one person who was, by the way, paid by the public administration, who represented all this diversity of the families. Yeah, I'm trying to conclude. Well, other points. And perhaps the most important one is that behind this Roma plan, and evidently my description is not sufficient so that you can understand it clearly, but in the very Roma plan, in the very school promotion project, there was no systematic change of the system, and in this sense, the system is the school, the structure. So there were no structural changes, there were no changes actually in teachers' training, school organization, rethinking of punishments, rethinking of dynamics, pedagogical aspects, whatever. So some conclusions. The project aiming participation are not transformative towards the school, not only as agent but also as a structure. And risk families should be assisted, but school practices are not called into question, nor teachers are made responsible for the proper implementation of the project. By the way, teachers were not evaluated as well as on this very same level as the promoter, for example. Another point is that the elusive notion of participation serves to introduce some neoliberal practices and logics, like outsourcing to services, in this case to the very promoter or mediator, Roma mediator, serves some kind of cost-cutting agenda. Evidently, the restructuring of school would cost a lot of money, in this sense, or the teacher's training as well. In this sense, we could collect empirical evidence to how participation operates as an authorizing narrative involving good feelings, presumed common understanding that are not to be questioned. And finally, I would like to highlight as well the instrumentalization of the NGOs, the very central NGO who managed, who handled all the funds and all the training and all the organization stuff. And in this case can also be seen, this instrumentalization, as an element of participatory processes through which NGOs' civic political potential becomes depoliticized and
it is transformed into professionalized social civic enterprise or enterprises. Furthermore, third sector organizations and their projects are exposed to a high level of dependence of public funding. So they are just some ideas, some of them surely you know, but to understand that all these, and generally I can generalize that many of the projects that are presented at the Spanish government or some large Spanish organizations conducted successfully, just I mean, this affirmation basically based on the lack of evaluation, a lack of critical evaluation.
Thank you, Abel. I think it was a very useful addition that we move from the civilized perspective to a critical analysis of concrete projects, which are actually in Spain not so different from some other countries. So the school mediator program is thriving in Romania, Macedonia, not so much in Hungary. But it was a very useful input. And last but not least, I would like to ask Iulius Rostas to reflect on the relevance of all this in the post-communist context. You have worked for several organizations that were inspired by, at least partly by the US experience, and you are familiar with the Spanish case, so please, the floor is yours.
Well, let me start first with this personal experience. I used to define myself as a Roma activist. And activist, you know, it sounds very neutral, but in fact, a good friend of mine told me, you know, you remember me of those communists, yeah, that used to go to do propaganda, convince people that this is how they should do. And in fact, he was right. That's what I tried to do in different capacities. I was hired, you know. And I had, in the 19 years experience of involvement in, you know, public issues with Roma, in different capacities, as a student, attending, you know, academic seminars, lectures, and so on. Then later on, worked for a government in the region, exactly on Roma. Then worked for a main human rights organization defending the rights of the Roma, the European Roma Rights Center. Then later on in Open Society Institute, the largest private donor in the region. Then I also worked for a research institute. And meanwhile, I consulted several organizations, including the European Commission and the World Bank. So I have a pretty good view on what was going on Roma. I had also time in the last years to reflect on some issues. And here is my view on empowerment. Yeah. First is that if we look at different social movements, especially you know, the ones that have also an ethnic or racial aspect, there is no model to follow for Roma. There are lessons learned that we can use them, but there is no model to follow. I agree with Michael that you know there are so many differences between US civil rights movement and a Romani movement that it's impossible to say, oh, this is the model to follow. There is not even the Zionist movement a model to follow, for so many reasons that, you know, easy. Roma do not claim necessarily a piece of land and so on. Yeah. I started looking even at Hamas. Now you'll say, you know, well, you know, but Hamas started very interesting as, a, you know, having a very important social dimension, something that many non-Roma expect from Roma activists and NGOs to do the same, go help your own people and so on. Now, this is not only stupid, but it's also racist. What? You know, if you get educated Hungarians or Americans, or, oh, you go back and you help your community. No, you first want to make a good life for yourself. Yeah. And then, if that happens to help your communities, country, and so on, yeah. But you are not this romantic hero that you give up your life and, you know, everything just to save others. That's also stupid. Yeah. So, I looked at that Hamas, yeah. I said, ooh, interesting. Now, even Hamas doesn't work, you know, because they got a lot of money, not only, you know, for terrorists and weapons and so on, but they got a lot of money from their friends outside, you know. Who wants to give money to Roma? Yeah. We all know that Roma still, yeah, so. But, now, basically, I never, you know, I was never an expert except for the part when I worked on for the government, because that was my title. Yeah. And I was not a leader. I think with the exception of Facebook, I don't have followers. Yeah. What kind of leader are you if you do not have followers? Yeah. But that says a lot about, you know, from what position you look at what happened. Now, I might be accused of, you know, oh, you want to take revenge against this and that. I think, you know, time passed, there are so many stuff happening, and it's more important, yeah, to look from a broader view than from a very personal, you know, unimportant aspect. When we talk about empowerment, there are so many meanings attached to it. Yeah. And there is a common belief that Roma are not interested in public things, you know, what goes on. And, you know, they are just, you know, passive and so on. No, they are very interested in what's going on, because that affects their life. And they do want to have a saying in matters affecting them. Yeah? And to me, that's the very simple and vulgar meaning of empowerment. To have a saying in matters that affects your community and your life directly. That's the base. Now, empowerment can be defined in many ways, and you know, somehow I put that definition as well. But what I found also interesting is another concept developed by a World Bank consultant in reference with some development projects in Southeast Asia, and that's the legal empowerment. Where the World Bank used legal empowerment to combat poverty in Southeast Asia. That's a very interesting concept developed by Stephen Golub. It basically consists of the use of rights and laws to take control of your own life, including decisions that you make as an individual or as a community. I think that's an interesting point of view to explore how human rights discourses might affect Roma, especially that, in my view, that was not properly analyzed yet, and the results are rather inconclusive, not to say negative. Well, when we talk about empowerment and we look what's going on in town, we find, I put down five concepts that are linked. One is dependency. Yeah. Now, there were all kinds of agencies, starting from governments to donors, intergovernmental or private donors, that somehow wanted to do good for Roma. And they went and they developed some projects, they pulled some money into different ideas. And in the end, the result was that they produced dependency. And now Roma became dependent on all kinds of you know, social benefits, on projects and so on, Roma communities. Now that's somehow normal, because Roma, unlike the popular beliefs, are smart people, yeah. If you get something for free, why not to take it? You know, especially when you are, however, maybe, you know, categorized in all kinds of negative terms. Why not together? Yeah. And this is how, in fact, the whole circle of dependency was created. Because these guys, these agencies, somehow had to reinvent their work. Bureaucrats had to justify their work. And this is how you do it. Yeah. So it's not only Roma. Then it's assistance. Well, assistance sounds much better, yeah. Well, let's give assistance to our mind, then we also try to empower them. But we saw somehow ERRC was set up based on the experience of NAACP. But unlike NAACP, for example, in its board, yeah, ERRC, I'm not talking, ERRC has a status that 50% of its members in the board should be Roma. The problem is who makes decisions, who is the important player there, and never was the case with Roma. But we assist them, we go, we do trainings, yeah, we empower them, but there is no connection. We assist, but, you know, Roma cannot make it, you know, they are too passive, and we don't look at, in fact, what we want to achieve. It's not the proper way to do. We better select smart students and invest in smart students. Yeah. But then do not expect that they will go back in communities, become heroes, get and fight with local authorities and so on. But the other concept that I linked with empowerment is control. Now, controlling Roma is a historical objective of authorities in Europe. Yeah. From the very first arrival, yeah, that became a main aim of policing. Yeah. In Middle Ages, police was the one to, you know, and policy sciences were the ones to deal with state administration and so on. Van Baar explains very well how this worked. And the main aim was to control Rome. Yeah. Now, communists had very clear idea how, you know, to control Roma, forcing different policies, for sedentarization, mandatory employment, mandatory education, and so on. And this became tools of social control of Roma. But that practice was not ignored. I mean, yeah, we like Roma and so on. We want to help them because, you know, all this. But we should tell them the way things work and how, you know, what are the limits of the game, until when they can go and where and so on. And I think the social control of Roma is still present in the nowadays policies. The best example, EU-Roma summit. Yeah. Now, if you look in the agenda and how this, you will see that Roma do not have a say, but all these guys go speak very nicely on what should be done. Some of them have some ideas, some of them are just politicians, and it's good to go and say, then participation. Now, participation will make or break the debate. Well, I don't know if it broke it, but however, the results are, you know, inconclusive. Yeah, Alice. What's interesting is that participation is not everything. It's also a matter of degree. Yeah. It's, if you really have a say, you might participate somewhere. Yeah. But do you have a say or not into that? Yeah. And sometimes you might have a say, but they, you know, they keep your side always. Yeah. You always are on the losing part. So that's also not okay. And then, of course, it's always good to have Roma, because not only because they are more exotic, but, you know, it's good to have your own Roma. And we saw that those kind of practices, you know. And sometimes Roma activists, leaders, and so on, speculated that. Yeah. Well, I felt quite strange in some of the positions I had when I was the Roma, you know, to play that. I accepted sometimes that position. I tried to use it for my best. I don't know if I managed, but, well. And then, we have to talk also, when we talk about empowerment, on capabilities. And I like very much, you know, Amartya Sen's view on development as freedom. When he talks about capabilities and functions, yeah, what a person or a group is doing or is able to do, and then what about the capabilities, what an individual or a group can do or can be. Yeah. And I think that's significant. That's significant. If we look at, from this aspect, we find we'll have a different analysis of Roma communities. Now, usually in political sciences, you need three rounds of elections to be able to say something definitive and to make an analysis and to comment on parties and so on. Yeah, results. Now we have somehow three rounds, yeah, of policy making towards Roma, more or less coordinated in Central and Eastern Europe. It was the first wave of national strategies at the end of '90s during the pre-accession period. Then we had the decade of Roma inclusion when these governments got together and then designed national action plans. And we have the EU framework for Roma integration, which is even more coordinated. Well, in all this, if you look how the participation of Roma happened, well, it's extremely, I think it decreased. Instead of increasing, yeah, let me put it this way. In the first round, because of the European Commission pressure, mostly, yeah, governments were forced to work with different Roma groups. Yeah, they liked or not, they were forced. In the decade of Roma inclusion, something else happened. There were, you know, the invention was to create in each country a group of 10 young Roma leaders that, you know, spoke, they were well educated, they could be a counterpart for the bureaucrats and be able to design policies. Well, what they ignored was that you should have, you know, there are no leaders that have no followers. And these guys were smart, were very good. Yeah. But they didn't have followers. So, in fact, they were just token Roma. So, how to make sure that Roma are part of the policy making and policy implementation, you know, was started, you know, quite bad. And it stopped during the process. It's a long story. In the EU framework for Roma integration, now that was, you know, completely disregarded. And somehow, Hungarian government, and especially a Roma, I don't know, call it leader or activist, yeah, Livia Jaroga, had also a big, you know, she was part of the mistake happening here. Why? Because Hungarian government, in its rush for glory, to show we did something, yeah, as EU holding the presidency of the EU, we have to adopt the EU framework strategy. No deliberation, it was a speedy process, and they did it. Yeah. Second, they imposed at the deadline, this was approved in 4th or 5th of April, 5th of April 2011, and by the end of the year, yeah, the governments were asked to send in national strategies. Now, how the hell to make it, you know, a process so fast? Of course, the easiest was either you do not include Roma, or you just pick some Roma, you know, the ones that, you know, are not critical, you want them, you know, they are your Roma. You design something on paper and say, here it is, we have them. And this is how happened with the EU framework. Well,
you're definitely, curious.
Yeah. What one can look at participation is that this is happening mainly through minority representation mechanisms, which is definitely not enough, for example, to combat poverty and to address other issues that Roma are facing. Then, when we look at NGO, especially Roma NGOs suffer a mutation that they assume preponderantly the representation function of Roma without any election and so on. Yeah. We set up a Roma NGO, and then since we are smart and we speak English, yeah, I'm sure in 1 year we'll become a very important voice for the Roma. It doesn't matter that we do not have too much to do with Roma. Yeah. But that's the way. And instead of doing something else, we claim to represent the Roma and to be the voice. And then, basically, there are no, in the policy making towards Roma, there is no deliberative process. Yeah. At all levels, especially at local level. Yeah. They are let's keep them aside. And something else that Abel raised is the knowledge production on Roma. And here I'm glad that you are all here, because directly or indirectly we have something to do with this. When we make decisions on Roma, when policymakers are put to make decisions, on what kind of knowledge they base their decisions? Assuming policymaking is a rational process. Well, knowledge production on Roma is one of the causes of why policy towards Roma are failing. It's not only that Roma are not involved in the process.
The paradise will be closer to Roma, the European paradise.
It was first to be
It depends. Definitely, you know, to me, you know, the best scenario is that European Commission people will come and will say, the first feedback we get from the field is that we are screwing up this process and it's better to reshape it. But that's not going to happen because it's the end of the mandate of one commission and they want to show that they are smart and generous. So this will not happen. It's funny that we have some really cool guys giving speeches there. One is Zoltan Balog, who even went in a court and gave a testimony in a court, basically saying that, you know, first we have to make Roma, accepting that Roma are not our equals, yeah? First we have to create separate classes and prepare them to integrate and then be our equals, yeah? So you have this racist going there and giving a speech about how Roma can be integrated, yeah? Can you imagine how this might be? We have the Romanian president, quite notoriously about, you know, his speeches about Roma, yeah, and so on. So he's also giving a speech. Then we have a mayor, you know, from Romania that gives also a speech, and she's, believe me,
she looks nice, aside of this.
Okay, that's a matter of personal preference, it's not my type, definitely. And then, you know, basically, not a lot, eventually nice speeches. It will not change anything, and eventually it will be a great opportunity for Roma to protest, Roma and non-Roma as well, to organize protests all over EU, claiming, where the fuck are we? Yeah. That should be the slogan.
Just a sentence, I am a moderator, but to respond to Valery, that it's, you know, what these advocacy efforts have been about, to convince or make politicians to declare that they care about Roma and they produce inclusion strategies that you are aware, and it is higher and higher level, and it's true that in the soon now the European Union and European Commission will attract very supposedly high level people who make nice declarations. But at the same time, as Michael said, the civil rights movement never directly converses with the politicians. Because unless you exert direct pressure, there will be no real change. So just to
that's not what I said.
Just I finished the sentence and I give you the floor. So to show you the political reality, that on the one hand you can make very nice declarations and speeches, but when you are inside the parliament as a Roma person, and in Hungary there are very few Roma people in the parliament, on an everyday basis you can hear that, why do you think that we want our children to go to school with your child? And so you can see that that is the declaration. On the other hand, the political and economic elite has no any serious wish or intention to go beyond the current segregation and the institutional racism. So that's why I'm a bit skeptical, and please now
just make a couple points, because quite often when people hear my point of view, they kind of counterpose me with, you know, the academic approach on the one hand, the political approach on the other, and I'm not counterposing. I'm talking about all of it, but I'm talking about who controls it. So that I don't go to a meeting hoping that you like me. Not when it's over my rights. I don't go to a meeting smiling when I ain't happy. Not when it's over my rights. Now I realize that I don't have, there is no such thing as an equilibrium there. So that the people who are the cause of me having a problem ain't gonna solve my problem. So, but, so then my only recourse is to create all sorts of things, again, to say, well, I tell you what, for the next week, you're gonna have a bad day, one day a week. I don't know what that may be. It could be blocking one of them bridges, petrophy. It could be breaking somebody's computer. It could be any number of things. But the goal is to sit in Brussels and get my rights. That's my goal. I'm not just trying to create trouble. I don't go to jail, but I'm willing to go to jail. And I disagree with you, by the way, on the point of you can't expect people to just start getting education and not take some opportunities. No, no, that's exactly what a generation has to do. That's exactly what a generation I know did, not just in the civil rights movement, but in South Africa, in Mozambique, in Guinea-Bissau, in Algeria. That's what the decolonization movement was a generation saying that this is my life. And so that now there are people that I know personally, Congressman John Lewis, one of the most revered people in the US, that I'd stay with him. Now, like, I think it's jive now, but he was cool then. Julian Bond, those who may know him, there are all sorts of people who were my equals as comrades. Now, the former mayor of Washington, D.C., Marion Barry. But there's a generation that says, pardon the expression, left the job, the TV, the car, this is what we're gonna do. The group I work for was called the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee. Now, even in $1960, though, we made $10 a week. $10 a week. Significantly amount of my comrades would have gone to Harvard. They're teaching at Harvard, not just went to Harvard. So we ain't talking about folks that, well, you ain't had no other choice, you had no skills. No, they had choices. But this is what we said we're gonna do. That, like, dog, we had no expense account. We used to go into towns, had to find a place to sleep. Sometimes we had to pick cotton to supplement that $10 a week, and they took taxes out of it. So it was $9.64. In fact, though, we made a slogan out of it. So that the point, and now, like, I don't act like we were something. You know, we knew this is what we had to do. But nobody liked that shit. No, man, I want to sit up in with a shirt and tie on like everybody else. I want a nice house like everybody else. And this is the fundamental thing I do want to make sure I stop. In 1964, they passed the 1964 Civil Rights Act, they call it, public accommodations. In 1965, they passed the Voting Rights Act. That's what the whole struggle in Selma, Alabama was about. So in terms of my personal reality, I got into the Southern movement in 1965. By the time I got into the movement, every significant civil rights bill that came out of the civil rights movement had been passed. But I was arrested over 11 times. Over 11 times. Over laws that had been passed. Because, and that's the thing about these so-called advocates of the Roma, I tell folks, what difference does it make what the European court did if some Roma and Shaokaza don't have no idea? And even if they do, who's gonna make that guy at the corner at that club let the Roma in? He don't give a damn about that law. So then they have a conference about, look at how bad we know we some badass lawyers, we got this done. It has no impact in the community. So just because you got a law, it means nothing. And in this reality, with Roma is much more, the oppression of Roma is much more entrenched, it means less than it did with us. So don't tell me about all the success you made. Unless you can tell me, because of what I did up here, it got changed down here. If you can't point that to me, Father, I'm saying you didn't do a damn thing. Because that's my test for success, is what is the quality of the life of the people that I claim to be working with or speaking on behalf of. If I can't say that's better, then I just got me a good job.
You had a question, Peter?
Yes, thanks. Actually, in the meantime, it became two. So, one is so do you think that is it possible to create somehow a Roma rights movement in a somewhat, at least somewhat bottom-up way?
Somewhat
bottom-up way, and with sort of more grassroots involvement, and if so, then what can be done to enable the communities to participate and initiate and empower, and then the other question is that I hope it's related, that is sort of, how would you compare the negative stereotypes and prejudices that are expressed in anti-Roma speech, anti-Black, anti-African-American speech, and also in discrimination, including segregation, that is also a communicative act in a way. So how would you compare these stereotypes and negative stereotypes and prejudices? And I'm raising this because, of course, this massive structure of negative stereotypes and prejudices is sort of like an inherent part of the structure of racism we are talking about. And then the similarities and differences matter in regard what ways we need to look for to change things.
I would ask all three to react, and maybe I could begin.
Yeah, I think that the question is, at least as far as your concern about bottom up is concerned, everybody participates. You participate, and not that much, but still, I participate in my social relations and social practices. But the question is that whenever bottom-up participation appears, public administration tends to, at least from my fieldwork that comes up, is that they need this kind of participating people. They need the movement. So what they do is just grab them, and at the very moment they disempower them in the sense that literature on that says that there are two types of the spaces of participation, the invited spaces and the local spaces or autochthonous spaces of participation. So there are two mistakes. One of the mistakes is that they create this kind of places of participation, and they invite you that look, we created a fantastic cultural center, and every Wednesday at 6 o'clock we would like that all the Roma guys come here and make some music and just enjoy yourself and participate. This is one thing, and perhaps on the street or whatever, in the church, in the evangelical church, there are no people who don't participate. So this is one mistake that you can see all the time. And the other mistake is when they realize that those people play music in the church, they do participate in the labor market, they are participating in the education of their children. Actually, they are resisting actively some structures,
So when they, when public administration realizes, they just point at these people and they say, come to participate in the policy, come to participate in empowerment plans to develop and whatever. And generally speaking, it doesn't work. So this kind of bottom up, I haven't really seen it, but surely it exists. I'm not sure.
Well, of course, but this has nothing to do with outside interventions, like, you know, donors and so on. On the contrary, there were the protests in Plovdiv, yeah, over the electricity company, yeah, that cut the electricity in Roma communities, yeah, in Bulgaria. That was an example of, you know, a movement that made clear demands. Another one was in February 2004 in Slovakia, when the government changed the law on social benefits, and then Roma rioted. Yeah. Now, what happened in Slovakia remains a big mystery, because for the, to the best of my knowledge, among the democratic states in Central and Eastern Europe, it was the first time when a government took out from the barracks the army for public order. Basically, nobody knows what went on in Slovakia, how they restored order. But definitely the protest ended. And there were few sporadic protests, protests like these that, you know, these were bottom up. On the contrary, I can give you many examples, when donors, try to undermine local movements or leaders, just because they were smarter. One example is, you know, in Bulgaria, in Facultetà, that's a neighborhood of close to 40,000 Roma. And there was a local leader. We might disagree, but he was the local leader. And then the National Soros Foundation in Bulgaria undermined all he did, basically, for that community, good or bad, but at least he had the, you know, community next to him, part of it, a significant part of it. But that's one example how a donor can screw up and also, you know, dismantle movement, community movement.
Just talk about the stereotypes for a second. If we look at a pictorial history of the U.S. civil rights movement in terms of protest, say, and just for the sake of this discussion, because it's ridiculous that our historians start, but let's start at the Montgomery bus boycott in 1955, which put Martin Luther King on the national stage. Well, and so, for people who know about that, do I know the name Rosa Parks? In fact, she's one of the few women, I think, in the capital. But because there were, I mean, because just in Montgomery, not outside Montgomery, because there were at least two other people who did exactly what Rosa Parks did. One was a teenage, the working class teenage girl, about 15 years old, girl, not woman, I use girl intentionally. Because she was a 15, 16 year old, father was alcoholic, and but she was pregnant. So the petty bourgeois leadership and the Montgomery said, oh no, we can't do that. No, we can't support her because she's going to make us look bad to the white folks. You know, we got to. So, and then there was another a woman. So that Rosa Parks wasn't the first, she was the first one to get supported. And I'm not trying to minimize Rosa Parks at all. She deserves every accolade she gets. So don't misunderstand my point. If you look at the pictures of civil rights marches. In fact, I remember the time when people were thrown out of a march if they didn't have on a tie and shirt, jacket, right? Because again, they were worried about how the white folks perceived us. But then you, if you notice into the 60s, 61, 62, 63, you look at pictures. Even on Martin Luther King, you look at pictures of him marching in Selma. And our folks have on blue jeans.
So now, what was the transition? Why did they go from the white shirts and ties to blue jeans and work clothes? Because people started working with the people that they were supposed to be about. And we set the paradigm because we began to realize that equality is not about getting all A's. Equality is not proving that we can be, quote, as smart as you. Equality is the right to be as mediocre as white people. Equality is to be as stupid as white people. Equality is to be as obnoxious as white people. That's what equality is. I don't judge it from how, no. I don't have to prove nothing. I don't give a damn if you never like me. I come here with the same rights as you. I ain't got to earn them. I don't have to prove nothing. And that's the attitude that we began. I don't care what you think about me wearing blue jeans. That's what we're going to wear because that's what that woman I'm working with in the cotton field is wearing. And goddamn, you draw any conclusion you want from that. That was a changing shift of paradigm. You're not, you know, all this notion of hate speech and shit, you cannot, you know, it's kind of like, well, if we kind of change the attitude of folks and they see that Roma are really people too, like us, and they, you know, and the Roma don't act too Roma when they're around us, maybe we'll give it a little taste. And my thing is that, like, there are friends of mine, even in the U.S., that don't go out with me because I will eat chicken with my hands. Fuck these people. I do what I want to do. You know, I mean, believe it or not, I've been known to lick my plate in public. Because you don't, I don't give a damn what you think of me. You don't control, and if I don't do it, it's because I'm in a black restaurant. But I don't care what they think. But in the context of a situation, but the point, the point I'm trying to get at is that like I don't have to earn my rights. And there's this, in this culture, I mean by this culture, I'm talking about the region, there's this paradigm of, you know, the Roma do this, and they do that, and they do that, and I said, you know, I mean, it's so ludicrous that I don't know what to say to it. But again, I say to folks, you do whatever the hell you want to do. If it's legal, you do it. And you still get your rights. I don't care what you think about what I'm doing. You just have to be pissed off.
Are there any other questions, comments, or?
Just one. Roma mediators, is it truly the most depressing thing that a sign of progress from the Council of Europe, the European Commission, is that we've got mediators and we're going to train them. The ones that are already trained, we're going to train them again and again. Now, during the age of empires, what you had were mediators. You had people who, because administering an empire and controlling imperial subjects was, you know, you couldn't just rely on coercion. Do it every so often. You know, you'd have a massacre to teach the natives a lesson, but in between, to make sure business flowed, you had mediators. Here in Europe, 21st century, the solution is to have mediators for Rome. That reduce the needs of, as you said, of very diverse, utterly in collections of individuals with their aspirations and needs are reduced to the category Roma. And the mediator, well-intentioned young people who have been trained, and qualifications that will not stand up in public service. So you can't step out after being trained and retrained and trained again by the Council of Europe as a mediator. You can't step into another profession. It isn't an accredited, recognized, and it costs a fortune. And this is being sold as a success. The fact that there's consensus around this and very little dissent about it is deeply worrying. So well-intended people are saying, mediators, what a great success. Romed 1, Romed 2, we're looking forward to Romed 3. And we'll have it blessed by a summit to say that this is a great thing and here's more millions to have train more mediators, or even retrain the same people again. So you mediate for your health, for their health, you mediate for their education, and they become the passive recipients of, again, neoliberal contracting out of what should be a person's right. Public services are contracted out to people who, with the best intention in the world, cannot deliver efficiently. And this abdication of states of their public responsibilities towards citizens and doing it in a nice, cosmetically acceptable way by reproducing mediators. Now, the fact that there's no groundswell of criticism coming from people who, social democrats, I haven't heard a word from one social democrat right across the European continent to say that mediators belongs to an age of empire. This is internal colonization. People are reduced to your needs, no matter how complex they are, can be reduced and can be mediated by one person we've nominated, we've trained, retrained. They don't have a professional qualification. It's not a university accredited qualification. It costs far. If you were to give people, say, okay, forget all this mediator, here's the cost of a university degree, here's the cost of, you'd save a fortune, but still there's going to be a chain of reproducing, write down things to go out and mediate. And the absence of any critical thought about this is shocking. And the fact that in the 21st century it's been sold as a good practice, because now they've become a bit more cautious. They no longer talk about best practice. Before, they used to package fraudulent projects as best practice. Projects that never happened during the FARA funding phase. Projects that simply didn't happen were being repackaged and printed in reports as good practice. Then we had best practice. And now what we're seeing is, so there's nothing, this is happening, it's costing millions, but it's being packaged now in the 21st century as a good practice that this community can have mediators. That their rights as citizens are reduced to what can be mediated by one nominated person. And again, it's no disrespect to the people who find themselves in this position, because they are, but the structures are such that no matter how well intended, no matter what capacity the individual has, their room for maneuver and the whole structures of power are such that what's happening is that they become ciphers. The needs, the rights of these citizens and children as rights-bearing citizens, not as, again, the offspring of their parents. The needs of children, the needs of elderly people, the needs of people with disabilities within the Roma community is reduced to being what a mediator can deliver and can say. And there is no dissent right across the political spectrum. In Brussels, in Strasbourg, and in the capitals, mediators is being packaged as a success. Can anyone explain this bland, unthinking consensus?
But maybe that's the solution. I mean, in Europe there's, 12 million Roma. Let's say a bit over, or about half of them are children. There's only 6 million. There's 6 million working Roma in Europe. Make them all mediators. Create a perfect organism of trainings. Calculate that there's never a gap. Everybody's training somebody at the same point. There's a perfect organism. Boom. Everybody has a job. There's
mandatory employment. And that will realize the communist dream. Roma proletarization, having 100% employment among Roma. And so on. What's the difference between EU and Soviet Union? Is that, EU takes more deliberation and it's less efficient, yeah. Their ideology, the other ideology, the best or worst, but, you could see something. These guys are too slow.
No, but actually what you mentioned is not that extreme, because there are some market niches which are invented for minority workers. And for example, NGOs, grassroots Roma NGOs, are this kind of, not the whole functioning of the NGO, but at least that they need some people, more or less school-educated people. So at the very moment they discover one guy who successfully finished primary school or secondary school, they just grab them and let's do projects for us and let's try to whatever, let's participate in Roma movement or whatever. And they create a market niche. And at least in Spain, this market niche is still open. I mean, you can find your place there. For example, in the way that Julius just mentioned that perhaps not as a leader in the NGO, but as a mid manager, you can find your place. So it's not that extreme, because even if they are not mediators, they are NGO people.
I suggest to take one or two more questions and then we could go informal. You have a question?
In Middle East, whenever there's an ethnic problem about human rights, everyone jumps to IMF, thinks about development, and they think it as a good solution because they don't consider the class a struggle. What do you think about, what do Roma communities think about IMF and loans and projects?
What I want to tell you is that there are not enough studies underlying how oppression, focusing on how Roma oppression works, how power structures work and are reproduced, how, you know, discourses on Roma are built, and how to tackle these power structures and discourses on Roma, yeah, how to build counter-narratives and so on, yeah. But when it comes to this development discourses, yeah, there was an evolution from the concept of social integration, yeah, used already by the communists then in early 90s, yeah. And then it came a little bit on rights discourses and then on what is now social inclusion. Yeah. Very vague and so on. And so we pull money into this. Well, one example I can give you is an analysis made by Hoed van Baar of activation policies, meaning employment stimulation packages in Slovakia, he made, yeah. And he shows, for example, that in spite of this generous aim, what the results led to were to take out from the labor market people that had, you know, a job there and make them dependent on these kind of projects to become beneficiaries, yeah, of these kind of projects. When projects end, that was over. So basically, they had a perverse effect on the development projects on Roma communities, though they had a very generous intention. So we need this kind of knowledge, yeah, to see how it works. World Bank, for example, now, and I'm proud somehow I consulted for them. Did a policy analysis. Let me tell you why. Let me tell you why. Okay, that sounds odd, eh?
Well, it did well,
didn't it? let me tell you something else. I've been better paid by many others, but why I went there was especially for ideological reasons, and I do expect that this will work out. Now they needed a policy diagnosis, Roma policy diagnosis in Romania, and they gave me the chapter on discrimination. Yeah. So everything is there. The report is not as, you know, I would have done it, but still major stuffs are there. Finally, after negotiations with the government, they will make it public in the 2nd of April. And meanwhile, the World Bank will put $1 billion in education for Roma in Romania, yeah, especially rural education. Now, I had a major disagreement with some World Bank people, especially when I worked in OSI, and I had to work with them, yeah, on this decade of Roma inclusion, about their funding for segregated schools in Romania. Basically, the government got loans from the World Bank and built separated schools in Roma neighborhoods, yeah, on this. And I had a major disagreement with them. Now, all this is in the report, yeah, about segregation and so on, and discrimination, that's not a good practice, and what are the results. So I am looking forward, yeah, to see what will happen with the 1 billion. And I am pushing the team that I work with to say, and that was the cost. Yeah, accepting a lower rate than I usually do, especially for from this. Yeah. For one saying, now let's create a commission where you have Roma into this to have a saying on how the government is going to spend $1 billion on Roma education. Yeah? Well, I hope they will take it up. I don't know. To me, they are smart guys. They should do it. But I'm not sure they want to.
One comment that I do want to make. Say that to people like us, if you will, and let's just say that like we have a common kind of at least interest, if not behavior, about human rights. That, and then I assume that because this room, I may be the only person in this room that but doesn't have a college degree, that the people like us think that regardless of the circumstances, that we can change the world. I mean, I've worked on anti-nuclear things in the Pacific. I mean, I've worked on environmental races. I mean, things that look intractable has never, that most of us would never say, well, look, I'm not doing it, that's too hard. We do the best we can with that, okay? So, but then because of our overall life, personal life in some regards, that we've had enough successes to affirm us as human beings. But then you get some people, be they African American, a woman in Philadelphia, who can't even get a stop sign to stop cars so that her child doesn't have to dodge cars every day to go to school, to a Roma woman in a village who is trying to survive and get the best education. I mean, that, like, I know in Serbia, I once was in a home with it because they didn't have electricity. The only time the woman used her generator was for her child to read, to study. So now you get people who can't even have that level of control in their life. So clearly, it's difficult for them on their own initiative to make change. So now, I say that to say that people like us, me, starting with me, we think that these people don't think. So we come in as their teachers. Say, look, the world is it. But no. The problem is they don't think that what they think matters. They don't think that what they think will change anything. So that my role, my only role, since I don't live there, is to convince them that not only what they think matters, but that they can change it. Once I've made that hurdle, then I'm the student. I'm no longer the teacher. But most of us try to stay in the role of the teacher. So we're going to be king of the gypsies. We're going to head to Brussels for them. And, I'll tell you what happens when we get back. But what we won't do is to give them the plane ticket and send them to Brussels. And if necessary, we hire them a translator and let them speak for themselves, because they know the problem. They don't think that they can do anything about it. Our role is to convince them that they can do something about it. At that point, you step back and take orders.
Thank you. I suggest that we go informal at this point, if you agree, all of you. I would like to thank Michael and Abel and Iulius for the inspirative speeches. And just a final announcement that we meet irregularly and in different pubs and places. And if you are not part of our mailing list or Facebook group, then please put your email address or name here. Yeah.
And you want to talk to me, cigarette smokers,
in there. Let's continue in the bar and outside. Yeah. Thank you for coming.
Just to answer our friend Michael about what's wrong with gypsies, very briefly. with a major difference between Roma and African American. And that's, the Romani language. When you have your own language, then that makes a difference.
Yes, yes,
and
yes,
then
yes,
there
yes.
are, you know, all kinds of explanations.
Right, right, right.
And we will talk about them, you know, while we have a beer or something. Yeah?
Thank you, sir.
The paradise will be closer to Roma, the European paradise.
It was first viewed. No, yeah, it depends. Definitely, you know, to me, you know, the best scenario is that European Commission people will come and will say, the first feedback we get from the field is that we are screwing up this process and it's better to reshape it. But that's not going to happen because it's the end of the mandate of one commission and they want to show that they are smart and generous. Yeah. So this will not happen. It's funny that we have some really cool guys giving speeches there. One is Zoltan Balog, who even went in a court and gave a testimony in a court, basically saying that, you know, first we have to make Roma, accepting that Roma are not our equals, yeah? First we have to create separate classes and prepare them to integrate and then be our equals, yeah? So you have this racist going there and giving a speech about how Roma can be integrated, yeah? Can you imagine how this might be? We have the Romanian president, quite notoriously about, you know, his speeches about Roma, yeah, and so on. So he's also giving a speech. Then we have a mayor, you know, from Romania that gives also a speech, and she's, believe me,
she looks nice aside of this.
Okay, that's a matter of personal preference, it's not my type, definitely. And then, you know, basically, not a lot, eventually my speeches. It will not change anything, and eventually it will be a great opportunity for Roma to protest, Roma and non-Roma as well, to organize protests all over EU, claiming, where the fuck are we? Yeah. That should be the slogan.
Just a sentence, I am a moderator, but to respond to Valery that it's, you know, what these advocacy efforts have been about to convince or make politicians to declare that they care about Roma and they produce inclusion strategies that you are aware of. And it is higher and higher level. And it's true that in the soon now the European Union and European Commission will attract very supposedly high level people who make nice declarations. But at the same time, as Michael said, the civil rights movement never directly converses with the politicians. Because unless you exert direct pressure, there will be no real change. So just to
that's not what I said.
Ah, okay. Just I finish the sentence and I give you the floor. So to show you the political reality that on the one hand you can make very nice declarations and speeches, but when you are inside the parliament as a Roma person, and in Hungary there are very few Roma people in the parliament. On an everyday basis, you can hear that, why do you think that we want our children to go to school with your child? And so you can see that that is the declaration. On the other hand, the political and economic elite has no any serious wish or intention to go beyond the current segregation and the institutional racism. So that's why I'm a bit skeptical. And please now,
just make a couple points, because quite often when people hear my point of view, they kind of counterpose me with, you know, the academic approach on the one hand, the political approach on the other, and I'm not counterposing. I'm talking about all of it, but I'm talking about who controls it. So that I don't go to a meeting hoping that you like me, not when it's over my rights. But I don't go to a meeting smiling when I ain't happy. Not when it's over my rights. Now I realize that I don't have, there is no such thing as an equilibrium there. So that the people who are the cause of me having a problem ain't gonna solve my problem. So then my only recourse is to create all sorts of things again, to say what I tell you what, for the next week, you're going to have a bad day, one day a week. I don't know what that may be. It could be blocking one of them bridges, petrophy. It could be breaking somebody's computer. It could be any number of things. But the goal is to sit in Brussels and get my rights. That's my goal. I'm not just trying to create trouble. I don't go to jail, but I'm willing to go to jail. And I disagree with you, by the way, on the point of you can't expect people to just get an education and not take some opportunities. No, no. That's exactly what a generation has to do. That's exactly what a generation I know did, not just in the civil rights movement, but in South Africa, in Mozambique, in Guinea-Bissau, in Algeria. That's what the decolonization movement was a generation saying that this is my life. And so that now there are people that I know personally, Congressman John Lewis, one of the most revered people in the U.S., that like to stay with him. Now, like, I think it's jive now, but he was cool then. Julian Bond, those who may know him. There are all sorts of people who were my equals as comrades. Now, the former mayor of Washington, D.C., Marion Barry. But there's a generation that says, pardon the expression, left the job. The TV, the car, this is what we're going to do. The group I work for was called the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee. Now, even in $1960, though, we made $10 a week. $10 a week. Significantly amount of my comrades would have gone hard. They're teaching at Harvard, not just went to Harvard. So we ain't talking about folks that, well, you ain't had no other choice, you had no skills. No, they had choices. But this is what we said we're going to do. That, like, dog, we have no expense account. We used to go into towns, had to find a place to sleep. Sometimes we had to pick cotton to supplement that $10 a week, and they took taxes out of it. So it was $9.64. In fact, though, we made a slogan out of it. So that the point, and now, like, I don't act like we were something. You know, we knew this is what we had to do. But nobody liked that shit. No, man, I want to sit up in with a shooting tie on like everybody else. I want a nice out like everybody else. And this is the fundamental thing I do want to make sure I stop. In 1964, they passed the 1964 Civil Rights Act, they call it, public accommodations. In 1965, they passed the Voting Rights Act. That's what the whole struggle in Selma, Alabama was about. So in terms of my personal reality, I got into the Southern movement in 1965. By the time I got into the movement, every significant civil rights bill that came out of the civil rights movement had been passed. But I was arrested over 11 times. Over 11 times. Times over laws that have been passed. Because, and that's the thing about these so-called advocates of the Roma, I tell folks, what difference does it make what the European court did if some Roma and Shaukaza don't have no idea? And even if they do, who's going to make that guy at the corner at that club let the Roma in? He don't give a damn about that law. So then they have a conference about, look at how bad we know we're some badass lawyers, we got this done. It has no impact in the community. So just because you got a law, it means nothing. And in this reality, with Roma is much more, the oppression of Roma is much more entrenched, it means less than it did with us. So don't tell me about all the success you made. Unless you can tell me, because of what I did up here, it got changed down here. If you can't point that to me, Father, I'm saying you didn't do a damn thing. Because that's my test for success, is what is the quality of the life of the people that I claim to be working with or speaking on behalf of. If I can't say that's better, then I just got me a good job.
You had a question, Peter? Or,
yes, yeah. Thanks. Actually, in the meantime, it became two. So, one is that, and it's to all of you, that, so do you think that, is it possible to create somehow Roma rights movement in a somewhat, at least somewhat bottom-up way, and somewhat bottom-up way, and with sort of more grassroots involvement, and if so, then what can be done to enable the communities to participate and initiate and empower. And then the other question is that I hope it's related, that is sort of, how would you compare the negative stereotypes and prejudices that are expressed in anti-Roma speech, anti-Black, anti-African-American speech, and also in discrimination, including segregation, that is also a communicative act in a way. So how would you compare these stereotypes and negative stereotypes and prejudices? And I'm raising this because, of course, this massive structure of negative stereotypes and prejudices is sort of like an inherent part of the structure of racism we are talking about, and then the similarities and differences matter in regard what ways we need to look for to change things.
I would ask all three to react, and maybe I could begin.
Yeah, I think that the question is, at least as far as your concern about bottom up is concerned, everybody participates. You participate, and I'm not that much, but still I participate in my social relations and social practices. But the question is that whenever bottom-up participation appears, public administration tends to, at least from my fieldwork, that comes up, is that they need this kind of participating people. They need the movement. So what they do is just grab them, and at the very moment they disempower them in the sense that literature on that says that there are two types of the spaces of participation, the invited spaces and the local spaces or autochthonous spaces of participation. So there are two mistakes. One of the mistakes is that they create this kind of places of participation, and they invite you that, look, we created a fantastic cultural center, and every Wednesday at 6 o'clock we would like that all the Roma guys come here and make some music and, you know, just enjoy yourself and participate. This is one thing, and perhaps on the street or whatever, in the church, in the evangelical church, there are no people who don't participate. So this is one mistake that you can see all the time. And the other mistake is when they realize that those people play music in the church, they do participate in the labor market, they are participating in the education of their children. Actually, they are resisting actively some structures. So when public administration realizes, they just point at these people and they say, come to participate in the policy, come to participate in empowerment plans to develop and whatever. And generally speaking, it doesn't work. So this kind of bottom up, I haven't really seen it, but
surely it exists.
Well, of course, but this has nothing to do with outside interventions like, you know, donors and so on. On the contrary, there were the protests in Plovdiv, yeah, over the electricity company, yeah, that cut the electricity in Roma communities, yeah, in Bulgaria. That was an example of, you know, a movement that made clear demands. Another one was in February 2004 in Slovakia, when the government changed the law on social benefits, and then Roma rioted. Yeah. Now, what happened in Slovakia remains a big mystery, because for the, to the best of my knowledge, yeah, among the democratic states in Central and Eastern Europe, it was the first time when a government took out from the barracks the army, yeah, for public order. Basically, nobody knows what went on in Slovakia, how they restored order, but definitely the protested ended. And there were few sporadic protests, protests like these that, you know, these were bottom up. On the contrary, I can give you many examples, yeah, when donors, yeah, try to undermine local movements or leaders, yeah, just because they were smarter. One example is, you know, in Bulgaria, in Facultetă, yeah, that's a neighborhood of close with 40,000, yeah, Roma, and there was a local leader, yeah. We might disagree, but he was the local leader. Yeah. And then the National Soros Foundation in Bulgaria undermined all he did, yeah, basically, for that community. Good or bad, but at least he had the, you know, community next to him. Part of it, a significant part of it. That's one example how a donor can screw up and also, you know, dismantle movement, community movement.
Just talk about the stereotype for a second. If we look at a pictorial history of the U.S. civil rights movement in terms of protest, say, and just for the sake of this discussion, because it's ridiculous that our historians start, but it started the Montgomery bus boycott in 1955, which put Martin Luther King on the national stage. Well, and so, because people who know about that, so I know the name Rosa Parks. In fact, she's one of the few women, I think, in the Capitol. But, because there were, I mean, because just in Montgomery, not outside Montgomery, because there were at least two other people who did exactly what Rosa Parks did. One was a teenage, the working class teenage girl, about 15 years, and girl, not woman, I use girl intentionally. Because she was a 15, 16 year old, father was alcoholic, and but she was pregnant. So the petty bourgeois leadership and the Montgomery said, oh no, we can't do that. No, we can't support her because she's going to make us look bad to the white folks. You know, we got to. So, and then there was another, a woman. So that Rosa Parks wasn't the first, she was the first one to get supported, and I'm not trying to minimize Rosa Parks at all. She deserves every accolade she gets, so don't misunderstand my point. If you look at the pictures of civil rights marches, in fact, I remember the time when people were thrown out of a march if they didn't have on a tie, shirt, jacket, right? Because again, they were worried about how the white folks perceived us. But then you, if you notice into the 60s, 61, 62, 63, you look at pictures. Even of Martin Luther King, you look at pictures of him marching in Selma, and our folks have on blue jeans. So now what was the transition? Why did they go from the white shirts and ties to blue jeans and work clothes? Because people started working with people that they were supposed to be about. And we set the paradigm because we began to realize that equality is not about getting all A's. Equality is not proving
that we can be quote as smart as you. Equality is the right to be as mediocre as white people. Equality is to be as stupid as white people. Equality is to be as obnoxious as white people. That's what equality is. I don't judge it from how, no. I don't have to prove nothing. I don't give a damn if you never like me. I come here with the same rights as you. I ain't got to earn them. I don't have to prove nothing. And that's the attitude that we began. I don't care what you think about me wearing blue jeans. That's what we're gonna wear, because that's what that woman I'm working with in the cotton field is wearing. And goddamn, you draw any conclusion you want from that. That was a changing shift of paradigm. You're not, you know, all this notion of hate speech and shit, you cannot, you know, it's kind of like, well, if we kind of change the attitude of folks and they see that Roma are really people too, like us, and they, you know, and the Roma don't act too Roma when they're around us, maybe we'll give it a little taste. And my thing is that, like, there are friends of mine, even in the U.S., that don't go out with me, because I will eat chicken with my hands. Fuck these people. I do what I want to do. You know, I mean, believe it or not, I've been known to lick my plate in public. Because you don't, I don't give a damn what you think of me. You don't control, and if I don't do it, it's because I'm in a black restaurant. I don't care what they think. But in the context of a situation, but the point, the point I'm trying to get at is that like I don't have to earn my rights. And there's this, in this culture, I mean by this culture, I'm talking about the region, there's this paradigm of, you know, the Roma do this and they do that and they do that. And I said, you know, I mean, it's so ludicrous that I don't know what to say to it. But again, I say to folks, you do whatever the hell you want to do. If it's legal, you do it. And you still get your rights. I don't care what you think about what I'm doing. You just have to be pissed off.
Are there any other questions, comments, or?
Just one. Roma mediators, is it truly the most depressing thing, that a sign of progress from the Council of Europe, the European Commission, is that we've got mediators and we're going to train them. The ones that are already trained, we're going to train them again and again. Now, during the age of empires, what you had were mediators. You had people who, because administering an empire and controlling imperial subjects was, you know, you couldn't just rely on coercion. Do it every so often. You know, you'd have a massacre to teach the natives a lesson, but in between, to make sure business flowed, you had mediators. Here in Europe, 21st century, the solution is to have mediators for Rome that reduce the needs of, as you said, of very diverse, utterly in collections of individuals with their aspirations and needs are reduced to the category Roma. And a mediator, well-intentioned young people who have been trained, and qualifications that will not stand up in public service. So you can't step out after being trained and retrained and trained again by the Council of Europe as a mediator. You can't step into another profession. It isn't an accredited, recognized, and it costs a fortune. And this is being sold as a success. The fact that there's consensus around this and very little dissent about it is deeply worrying. So well-intended people are saying, mediators, what a great success. Romed 1, Romed 2, we're looking forward to Romed 3. And we'll have it blessed by a summit to say that this is a great thing, and here's more millions to have trained more mediators, or even retrain the same people again. So you mediate for your health, for their health, you mediate for their education, and they become the passive recipients of, again, neoliberal contracting out of what should be a person's right. Public services are contracted out to people who, with the best intention in the world, cannot deliver efficiently. Mm-hmm. And this abdication of states of their public responsibilities towards citizens, and doing it in a nice, cosmetically acceptable way by reproducing mediators. Now, the fact that there's no groundswell of criticism coming from people who, social democrats, I haven't heard a word from one social democrat right across the European continent to say that mediators belongs to an age of empire. This is internal colonization. People are reduced do your needs, no matter how complex they are, can be reduced and can be mediated by one person we've nominated, we've trained, retrained. They don't have a professional qualification. It's not a university accredited qualification. It costs far. If you were to give people, say, okay, forget all this mediator, here's the cost of a university degree, here's the cost of, you'd save a fortune, but still there's going to be a chain of reproducing, write down things to go out and mediate. And the absence of any critical thought about this is shocking. And the fact that in the 21st century it's been sold as a good practice, because now they've become a bit more cautious. They no longer talk about best practice. Before, they used to package fraudulent projects as best practice. Projects that never happened during the FARA funding phase. Projects that simply didn't happen were being repackaged and printed in reports as good practice. Then we had best practice. And now what we're seeing is, so there's nothing, this is happening, it's costing millions, but it's being packaged now in the 21st century as a good practice that this community can have mediators. That their rights as citizens are reduced to what can be mediated by one nominated person. And again, it's no disrespect to the people who find themselves in this position, because they are, but the structures are such that no matter how well intended, no matter what capacities the individual has, their room for maneuver and the whole structures of power are such that what's happening is that they become ciphers. The needs, the rights of these citizens and children as rights-bearing citizens, not as, again, the offspring of their parents, the needs of children, the needs of elderly people, the needs of people with disabilities within the Roma community is reduced to being what a mediator can deliver and can say. And there is no dissent right across the political spectrum. In Brussels, in Strasbourg, and in the capitals, mediators is being packaged as a success. Can anyone explain this bland, unthinking consensus?
Maybe that's the solution. I mean, in Europe there's, 12 million Roma. Let's say, a bit over, or about half of them are children. There's only 6 million. There's 6 million working Roma in Europe. Make them all mediators. Create a perfect organism of trainings. There's never a gap. Everybody's training somebody at the same point. There's a perfect organism. Boom. Everybody has a job. There's
mandatory employment. And that will realize the communist dream. Roma proletarization, having 100% employment among Roma. So, the difference between EU and Soviet Union is that, EU takes more deliberation and it's less efficient, yeah. Their ideology, the other ideology, the best or worst, but, you could see something. These guys are too slow.
No, but actually what you mentioned is not that extreme, because there are some market niches which are invented for minority workers. And for example, NGOs, grassroots Roma NGOs, are this kind of, not the whole functioning of the NGO, but at least that they need some people, more or less school-educated people. So at the very moment they discover one guy who successfully finished primary school or secondary school, they just grab them and let's do projects for us and let's try to whatever, let's participate in Roma movement or whatever. And they create a market niche. And at least in Spain, this market niche is still open. I mean, you can find your place there. For example, in the way that Julius just mentioned that perhaps not as a leader in the NGO, but as a mid manager, you can find your place. So it's not that extreme, because even if they are not mediators, they are NGO people.
I suggest to take one or two more questions and then we could go informal. You have a question?
In Middle East, whenever there's an ethnic problem about human rights, everyone jumps to IMF, thanks for development, and they think it as a good solution because they don't consider the class a struggle. what do you think about, what do Roma communities think about IMF and loans and projects?
But what I want to tell you is that there are not enough studies underlying how oppression, focusing on how Roma oppression works, how power structures work and are reproduced, how, you know, discourses on Roma are built, and how to tackle these power structures and discourses on Roma, yeah, how to build counter-narratives and so on, yeah. When it comes to this development discourses, yeah, there was an evolution from the concept of social integration, yeah, used already by the communists then in early 90s, yeah, and then it came a little bit on rights discourses and then on what is now social inclusion, yeah, very vague and so on. And so we pull money into this. Well, one example I can give you is an analysis made by Hoed van Baar of activation policies, meaning employment stimulation packages in Slovakia, he made, yeah. And he shows, for example, that in spite of this generous aim, what the results led to were to take out from the labor market people that had, you know, a job there, and make them dependent on this kind of projects to become beneficiaries, yeah, of this kind of projects. When projects end, that was over. So basically, they had a perverse effect on the development projects on Roma communities, though they had a very generous intention. So we need this kind of knowledge, yeah, to see how it works. World Bank, for example, now, and I'm proud somehow I consulted for them. Did a policy analysis. Let me tell you why. Let me tell you why. Okay, that sounds odd.
Well, it did well.
Let me tell you something else. I've been better paid by many things, but why I went there was especially for ideological reasons, and I do expect that this will work out. Now they needed a policy diagnosis, Roma policy diagnosis in Romania, and they gave me the chapter on discrimination. So everything is there. The report is not as, you know, I would have done it, but still major stuffs are there. Finally, after negotiations with the government, they will make it public in the 2nd of April. And meanwhile, the World Bank will put $1 billion in education for Roma in Romania, yeah, especially rural education. Now, I had a major disagreement with some World Bank people, especially when I worked in OSI, and I had to work with them, yeah, on this decade of Roma inclusion, about their funding for segregated schools in Romania. Basically, the government got loans from the World Bank and built separated schools in Roma neighborhoods, yeah, on this. And I had a major disagreement with them. Now, all this is in the report, yeah, about segregation and so on, and discrimination, that's not a good practice, and what are the results. So I am looking forward, yeah, to see what will happen with the 1 billion. And I am pushing the team that I work with to say, and that was the cost, yeah, accepting a lower rate than I usually do, especially from this, yeah, for one saying, now let's create a commission where you have Roma into this, to have a saying on how the government is going to spend $1 billion on Roma education. Huh? Well, I hope they will take it up. You know, I don't know, if, you know, to me, they are smart guys. They should do it. But I'm not sure they want to.
One comment that I do want to make. Say that, to people like us, if you will, and let's just say that, like, we have a common kind of, at least interest, if not behavior, about human rights. That, and then I assume that, because this room, because I may be the only person in this room that but doesn't have a college degree, that the people like us think that regardless of the circumstances, that we can change the world. I mean, I've worked on anti-nuclear things in the Pacific. I mean, I've done the work on environmental races. I mean, things that look intractable has never, you know, that most of us would never say, well, look, I'm not doing it, that's too hard. We do the best we can with that, okay? So, but then because of our overall life, personal life in some regards, that we've had enough successes to affirm us as human beings. But then you get some people, be they African American, a woman in Philadelphia, who can't even get a stop sign to stop cars so that her child doesn't have to dodge cars every day to go to school, to a Roma woman in a village who is trying to survive and get the best education. I mean, that, like, I know in Serbia, I once was in a home with, because they didn't have electricity. The only time the woman used a generator was for her child to read, to study. So now you get people who can't even have that level of control in their life. So clearly, it's difficult for them on their own initiative to make change. So now, I say that to say that people like us, me, starting with me, we think that these people don't think. So we come in as their teachers. Say, look, you know, the world is it. But no. The problem is they don't think that what they think matters. They don't think that what they think will change anything. So that my role, my only role, since I don't live there, is to convince them that not only what they think matters, but that they can change it. Once I've made that hurdle, then I'm the student. I'm no longer the teacher. But most of us try to stay in the role of the teacher. So we're going to be king of the gypsies. We're going to head to Brussels.
It's a good job. It's a good job.
Yeah.
Good job.
You know, we're going to head to Brussels for them. And, you know, I'll tell you what happens when we get back. But what we won't do is to give them the plane ticket and send them to Brussels. And if necessary, we hire them a translator and let them speak for themselves, because they know the problem. They don't think that they can do anything about it. Our role is to convince them that they can do something about it. At that point, you step back and take orders.
Thank you. I suggest that we go informal at this point, if you agree, all of you. I would like to thank Michael and Abel and Iulius for the inspirative speeches. And just a final announcement that we meet irregularly and in different pubs and places. And if you are not part of our mailing list or Facebook group, then please put your email address or name here.
Yeah. And want to talk to me, cigarette smokers in there.
Let's continue in the bar and outside. Yeah. Thank you for coming.
Just to answer our friend Michael about what's wrong with gypsies, you know, very briefly. with a major difference between Roma and African American. And that's, the Romani language. When you have your own language, that makes a difference.
Yes, yes,
and
yes,
then
yes,
there
yes.
are, you know, all kinds of explanations.
Right.
And we will talk about them, while we have a beer or something.
Thank you, sir.